And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my extraordinary privilege to introduce the next speaker who will close this morning's session. What do you say about a man who becomes a professor at Harvard Law School at an extraordinarily early age, writes the magisterial treatise, American Constitutional Law, that led the late Dean Griswold to say that no person, not a Supreme Court justice, has ever had more influence on the constitutional law, not only of the United States, but of nations around the world developing new constitutions? What do you say of a man who has contributed so much wisdom about constitutional law, not only to his students who adore him and shower him with teaching prizes year after year, that helped elevate him to become a university professor at Harvard, one of the few places that, as one of the few professors ever to be given that vaunted title, and one of the very few from the law school to have done so alongside physicists and Nobel Prize winners in other fields. But what do you say of a man who has also contributed his knowledge and wisdom about constitutional law to the nation through other parts of government, testifying so many times on constitutional issues before the United States Congress that the late Senator Edward Kennedy once called him the 101st Senator? What I can say about Larry Tribe, who now serves as a special counsel in the Justice Department with the important task of trying to ensure equal access to justice for the unrepresented, the very task we've just heard this magnificent panel address today. What I can say about Larry Tribe is that he is a man, in addition to that prodigious intellect, that extraordinary amount of public service, a man of unbounded compassion and generosity and idealism and care for others, not only to his beloved family, his beloved students, but to all who are ever so lucky as to work with him. And to have had him as my mentor and my friend these last 30 years, I count as one of the greatest blessings of my life. Please welcome Professor Laurence Tribe, from DOJ.
Well, thank you all very much. What do you say about someone who is the greatest advocate of her time, has won more teaching prizes than anybody, an extraordinary scholar, and a wonderful friend? You say that she is much too generous in her assessments of her friends. That said, I really enjoyed the panel, and my task is to say a few things in reflecting on what I heard. And I heard a lot that was intriguing. I heard a lot about the spirit of acquiring knowledge. That's what I think Jim Greiner is all about. And the initiative that I'm heading up in the Department of Justice at the request of the President and of the Attorney General focuses very much on learning more about what works and what doesn't, more about what the actual justice gap in the United States is. For example, much of what we heard today involved looking at pro se filings. But of course, that leaves out what I would call the cat that didn't meow or the dog that didn't bark. And we've learned that some of those cats perhaps shouldn't have meowed. The person who comes in to a self-help center and says, and I saw this person myself when I visited Judge Matz's self-help center, which is remarkable, says, I'm being followed by a cop who has a voice but no body. Or someone else who says, I want to file a lawsuit against Lucifer. So clearly, some of those dogs that didn't bark, the filings that didn't get made, represent success stories for pro se clinics. But there is the vast iceberg below the surface of people who don't know what their legal claims are, federal or state. People for whom the system is obscure beyond belief, almost inconceivably difficult to navigate. People who never hear about the self-help center, people who come even to the best ones. And when I visited Judge Matz's center, I saw a sign. It said, Unrepresented Pro Se Litigants. And I wondered, as I saw one person look into the room and then back away, I wondered, does everybody understand what that means? And I got a commitment from the head of his center, and I made her shake on it, that that sign would be changed to say, people without lawyers. it's simple things like that. And I want a before and after photograph, Judge Matz, to show that she kept her commitment. Much of what my initiative is doing is looking around the country, seeing what works, and seeing how even what works well can be dramatically improved. And you've heard here, both in the example from Judge Aspin and in the example from Judge Matz, two of the pioneering and best programs in the country. So the acquisition of knowledge and the spirit of inquiry is one of the things that I heard and liked. Second, I think, is what I would call an activist posture. Certainly both Judge Matz and Judge Aspin are activists, not in the ideological sense that is so frequently used to express results with which one doesn't agree. Oh, he's an activist judge on the right or an activist judge on the left. Activist not in the sense of departure from objectivity and neutrality, but in the sense of distinction from indifference and passivity. There's nothing in the judicial canons that says that judges have to sit on Mount Olympus, wait till matters come to them, and then resolve them, and not make their courtrooms user-friendly. There's wonderful work by, among others, Richard Zorza, and I would commend to you his study called The Self-Help Friendly Court, designed from the ground up to work for people without lawyers, a study in 2002. There's nothing in the judicial canons that prevents judges from accepting an affirmative obligation to make sure that those who might need justice in their courtrooms, whether when they are represented or when they are trying and struggling to represent themselves, can find their way to some decent result. Indeed, 8 years ago, the Conference of State Chief Justices and the Conference of State Court Administrators jointly issued a resolution, and I quote it, "Courts have an affirmative obligation to ensure that all litigants have meaningful access to the courts, regardless of representation status. All litigants." And as I met some of the litigants both in Judge Matz's court and in the LA Superior Court, in the court that was considering family cases, I was deeply moved by how much obvious difference it was making in the lives of these litigants, that they had a clue what was going on. I met, for example, in Judge Matz's court, a man who was not indigent, and the problems that my initiative is looking at are very much problems not only of the very poor, but of the working class and the aspiring middle class. This fellow had written a song, and he was convinced it had been stolen and exploited for commercial purposes around the country. I checked later with some of the lawyers in the center to see whether they thought, having spoken to him a couple of times, that he may have had a meritorious case, and the answer is yes. And I asked him, well, why didn't you just get a lawyer to represent you on a contingent fee basis? There was potentially a good bit of money involved. He said, I went to such a lawyer, but he would never answer my calls. I didn't understand what he was talking about. I had no idea what progress the case was making. I cried for 4 days. I got my daughter to help me. My wife is helping me. This was my whole life. And now, at least, I know what's going on. They tell me how to file these papers. I've worked on it. I feel that I'm in control of my life. And I heard that from one person after another. Battered women, small business people, people who are very poor, people who are not so poor. Now, we need ways of measuring and defining success. I very much agree. But we can't hope to do that just by counting how many housing tenants might or might not win or lose. There was an interesting paper by Gary Blasi, which looked at 151 people who were involved in eviction proceedings and who had habitability defenses. And he noticed that in all 151 cases, there was just no correlation. The only ones who won were ones who had lawyers. And the ones who were unrepresented had no success whether they went to a self-help clinic or not. And he reached a conclusion from that about the importance and value of lawyers. One could look at other studies and reach opposite conclusions, but that's partly because the studies are not randomized, they're not controlled, they don't draw distinctions between proceedings of various levels of complexity, and between lawyers and lawyers, depending on the specialty. There's one joke I like in The New Yorker, shows a guy at a cocktail party, he's hitting on somebody, and he says, rather proudly, "Yes, I am a lawyer, but not in the pejorative sense." Clearly, there are lawyers of all kinds, and we need to know more about what enables them to provide useful service and what does not. So that's the activist posture, an important posture in making courts accessible so that people are not frustrated at the impossible prospect of navigating an opaque labyrinth. And then I heard a third theme, in addition to acquisition of knowledge and activism, and that was the audacity of hope, perhaps a familiar phrase to some in this room. And that's what I heard Jim Brosnahan doing. He listed 10 things. I counted 11, but maybe we're counting in base 7, I don't know. All of them are interesting, exciting prospects. All of them, I think, are worth trying. But what we have to realize is that we do face a crisis. I spoke a couple of weeks ago to the National Conference of State Chief Justices. 47 of the 50 were there. They didn't agree about everything, but one thing they all agreed about was that the system of justice in this country, and they knew, of course, mostly about the state courts, but the problem is only marginally less severe in the federal courts. The system is a house on fire. It's badly broken. Most of the responsible studies that I've looked at tend to show that something like one out of every, what are the numbers? Something like four out of every five poor people, defining poor in a fairly standard way, have serious legal needs that are unmet, and that three out of every five middle-class people have serious legal needs that are unmet. That's unacceptable in a country of this kind. And I think we should all be extremely grateful that there are judges who accept the idea that they need affirmatively to struggle with this problem. Now, that doesn't mean they have to adopt the inquisitorial model or a hybrid between the inquisitorial model and the adversary model. It means they need to be innovative, and it means they need to help the courts in which they work promulgate much clearer rules about what forms of outreach by the clerk's office are appropriate, what forms are mandatory, what forms should be forbidden because they trample on the important core principles of avoiding unauthorized practice of law. Part of what leads to passivity and paralysis in America's courtrooms, both state and federal, is a sense of unclarity and confusion about just what it's appropriate to do. How interactive can you be when someone comes in and wants help identifying a legal problem and filing a complaint? And if everyone here who is a judge and everyone here who knows a judge and has influence over a judge can persuade that member of the judiciary to work hard on making sure that the courtroom in which he or she sits and the courthouse over which he or she exercises authority promulgates clear rules for where you can act without crossing the line of unauthorized practice of law, what kinds of help you can provide, then all of these desperate people, poor and middle class alike, who sometimes avoid your courtrooms because they find them incomprehensible, sometimes wander into the courthouse and have no idea where to go, they can find a kind of justice. And that was one thing that I must say, as I contemplated the discussion today, left me a bit disturbed. The focus was very much on the impact on the courts and on judges and on represented litigants of this plague of the unrepresented, whereas I'm charged, and I hope many of you take it as your charge, to worry about the impact on the unrepresented, the impact on people who don't have help, not how much trouble do they cause us and how much can we streamline our lives by providing appropriate dispute resolution, as Dorothy Nelson has devoted her life to doing, or by providing one or another kind of help, but how much can we do for them? Sort of ask not what they can do for us, but what we can do for them. One of my closest friends and one of Kathleen's predecessors as Dean of Stanford Law School, John Hart Ely, had a favorite question, a favorite observation. The wrong answer is what the wrong question begets. And I think the wrong question is, how can we help our lives by dealing with the unrepresented? The right question is, how can we perform our service, our public service, to the judicial, to the system of justice of the United States, to the delivery of justice, by focusing on the problems of those whose access to justice is illusory, lest the promise of equal justice under law become a promise to the ear to be broken to the hope, like a munificent bequest in a pauper's will. Thank you very much.